Assalamu alaikum and good evening. I would first like to introduce our guest speakers this evening, Aminah Assilmi and Deborah Scroggins. Then I will discuss the format for tonight's debate. Aminah Assilmi was born in Oklahoma on May 21, 1977. After 2 years of intensive study, she reverted and became a Muslim. We use the term reverted, not converted, because everyone we believe is born a Muslim. She currently lives in Orange County, California, and will be locating to Oklahoma in the near future. She has 3 degrees in education, communications, and broadcasting. She is an internationally known lecturer on Islam, including the status of women and families in Islam. She is presently chair of the International Union of Muslim Women and is active in many other Muslim organizations. She is a writer and is currently working on a book on women in Islam called The Achievable Dream. She is a mother and a grandmother. Deborah Scroggins, our other guest speaker tonight, was born and raised and lives in Atlanta. She has a Bachelor of Arts in History from Tulane and a Master in International Affairs from Columbia. She has worked as a staff writer for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution for the last 5 years, covering foreign and domestic affairs. She is the winner of the Robert F. Kennedy and Overseas Press Club Awards for human rights reporting on the Horn of Africa. And she is author of the recent newspaper series, Women of the Veil. The format for tonight's debate consists of 3 parts. The first part will consist of an opening statement of up to 20 minutes made by tonight's speakers. Aminah Assilmi will speak first and Deborah Scroggins will go second. After the opening statements, there will be a discussion between the two speakers led by myself on areas of contention or agreement appearing from the opening statements or addressed in the Women of the Veil articles, which may not have been specifically discussed in the opening statements. The third and final part of the debate will consist of a question and answer session. Questions may be submitted in writing to the moderator or asked directly from the microphones, which are located in the aisles. Any questions or comments from the floor will be limited to 1 minute in order that as many questions as possible may be answered. I would also encourage you, if you are going to submit written questions, to pass them to the person on the aisle. Someone from the MSA will walk up and down the aisles and collect the questions. We really don't want people standing in the aisles or moving up and down the aisles because of the nature of the hall. Now, at this time, I would like to ask Aminah Assilmi to give an opening talk to you this evening concerning the role and the status of women in Islam.
Assalamu alaikum. Tonight, I'm here to discuss that poor oppressed creature known as the Muslim woman and that law that oppresses them, Islam, specifically fundamental Islam. Islam is my chosen path, and I get really frustrated when I read about how women are paradoxically on the front lines of a movement that represses them. Islam in no way represses anyone. Islam is, in fact, the ultimate liberator. The women's liberation movement of this country would have benefited enormously from the guidance in the Quran. But then if we'd been following the Quran, the women's liberation movement wouldn't have been necessary. In Islam, it is recognized that men and women are different. However, while they're recognized as different, that in no way means that they are not equal. In fact, they are very muchly equal, as was mentioned in the ayah that opened. The Quran, which was revealed to Muhammad, was written down at the time of the revelation and has been protected from any change, stands now as it was then, and it stands as a constant reminder and protector of women's rights. No aspect of the woman's value, import, or capabilities has been ignored. Amongst the things that are covered in the Quran is procreation. In Surah 4, Ayah 1, it says, reverence God through whom ye demand your mutual rights, and reverence the womb that bore you, for God ever watches over you. The mother that bore us must have our reverence. The wife through whom the men enter parentage must have their reverence. And the act of sex itself must also be looked at with reverence. Also, the birth of female children was covered in Islam. According to Islam, the female child is not a matter of shame. It's a blessing. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever does good to a girl child, it will be a curtain to him from hell. Another time he said, whosoever cares for two girls till they come of age shall be in the next world with me like two fingers close to each other. Whosoever has a daughter and does not bury her alive, nor scold her, nor show partiality to his other male children, God shall bring him into paradise. Islam also dealt with another thing that's been a problem for women. That's the guilt for the original sin. After all, it was Pandora that opened the box that let evil onto the earth. And it was Eve who forced that fateful apple into Adam's mouth. But in the Quran, it says both were tempted, both sinned, both repented, and both were forgiven. Some people think that the man may be held slightly more responsible for original sin because the man is also given a degree of responsibility for the woman, where the woman has no responsibility for the man's actions. Women were also given, over 1,400 years ago, the right to own her own property and to conduct her own affairs. Now remember, the Quran is over 1,400 years old. In 1870, Great Britain shocked the rest of the world by passing the Married Women's Property Act. The law gave only limited property rights to women, but it was considered quite scandalous at the time. That was only the beginning of women's property rights. Even here in this country, there are some areas where women do not have full property rights. Last year when I was in Virginia, I was talking with an elderly lady whose husband had passed away, and she was trying to sell her house and could not because of a law that was on the book that said her husband or other male family member had to sign the papers, and every male family member she had was dead. And she was stuck with this house and she wanted to sell it. According to Islam, we have full control over whatever we own and full right to acquire whatever we desire. There's no limitations on us at all. And what we own does not require any permission from our husbands to use or dispose of. We also have the right to conduct our own businesses. In fact, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam worked for a woman who later became his wife. It was Khadija who owned the trading company that he went to work for when he was 20 years of age. That set two examples. Number one, that it was acceptable for a man to work for a woman. And number two, that it was acceptable for a woman to own a business and conduct her own affairs in that business. Also in Islam, women were for the first time given the right to witness contracts. Now it's true that in some cases in Islam it requires two women to one man, but this is only in certain contracts where it involves the borrowing and loaning of money. There are other instances where a woman's witness alone is enough, and there is one instance where a woman's witness is more powerful than a man's witness. The rights of women didn't stop here. The previously mentioned rights were then secured and expanded by granting women the right to education. Not just the right to education. Women were ordered to be educated. We were told to go to the ends of the earth if necessary. Slaves could be freed for teaching a woman how to read and write. It wasn't a matter of just men. It was for women too. The education of the women may well have been a factor in the number of women in early Islamic history who became known as distinguished scholars. Amongst those are Hafsa, the daughter of Omar, who was known as the keeper of the Quran, Aisha, daughter of Abu Bakr, who is well known for a memory like a tape recorder and reported the most hadiths of anyone. She also wrote many scholarly works on history and on Islamic law. But along with the right for education, we were given the right to express ourselves. We were given a right to voice our opinions and our ideas and our feelings in public. On one occasion, Omar, and for those of you who don't know about Omar, Omar was he was one very tough man. He was well known to have a quick temper and a very strong nature, and he wasn't the kind of person that anybody really cared to cross. But there was one occasion where he was suggesting that a law be passed, and a woman stood up and continued to disagree with him until finally he stood and said, a woman is right and Omar is wrong. So even right after the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we could stand before the caliph, the ruler, and disagree and express our opinion and have no fear. Our opinion was taken for what it was, and it didn't matter whether we were male or female. Judgment was judgment. Islam as a legal system also dealt with the issue of inheritance. Now, inheritance has been a problem over all years and is still a problem in this country especially. You watch families totally torn apart because they can't decide what's going to be done with an inheritance. The first thing Islam did was classify inheritance. And inheritance is not something you have earned. Inheritance is something that has been given to you. It's a kind of a charity. Now, in Islam, the woman has no financial obligations. Even in the worst of times, she has no financial obligations. If she has a job, she does not have to use that money to support herself. Her father is responsible, her brothers are responsible, her uncles are responsible. If there are no male relatives, the society is responsible. The man, on the other hand, has an almost unlimited degree of responsibility. He's responsible for his wife and for his children. He's responsible for his parents, for his brothers, for his sisters. He's responsible for the parents of his wife. He's responsible for aunts and uncles. He's responsible for any of the poor and needy in his community, and it goes on and it goes on and it goes on. So if a charity is to be given, it should go where it would be most needed, and that would be the man, because he has the greater stress placed on him financially. The thing that is quite remarkable and everyone keeps passing by is the fact that woman was guaranteed a part of inheritance. There are still many legal systems where all inheritance goes to the firstborn son or this or that, but this was the first and is still the only one that states absolutely how much she's going to get. And it goes beyond that because it keeps the family from being torn apart by arguing over who's going to get how much. It's settled. It's resolved. There's nothing to discuss. And it's a great burden that is relieved from all of society for this. Okay, now we move on into marriage. In the process of getting married, it's very true that the families on both sides are very involved in the marriage. They do a great deal of work finding people that they think are suitable for their son or for their daughter. But this in no way means that the daughter is bought or sold or that marriages are done without permission. A couple cannot be married unless they agree to the marriage. This is Islamic law now, okay? The family involvement, though, is very important. because the family should know their children fairly well. I mean, I know what my sons really like. I know what my sons really need. I knew what my daughter needed. I knew what my daughter wanted. And so when I'm talking to the girls, my daughter's married, but when I'm talking to the girls about my sons, I can have a pretty good feel about whether or not this girl is really going to be able to make it with my son, or whether there's too many areas where contention is going to be a source of absolute destruction in the household. Now, my oldest son, who's 17, he doesn't look at girls with his mind. He has a totally different orientation. But alhamdulillah, he does respect his mother, and he does listen to me, and he has taken my advice up to this point on girls that he has brought to me. And the one that he's currently considering is the first one that both of us are in agreement seems to be a pretty nice girl. But by going through this process, inshallah, we will be able to avoid problems in the marriage and maybe even divorce. The involvement in the marriage doesn't end with the choosing or the helping of the choice of the spouse, okay? It goes on in that the family is continually involved. We have extended family system in Islam. You don't get married and go off and become a totally separate unit. You get married, you become a part of a larger unit. And this extended family system helps us to be able to work out our problems a little bit better, too. We have other people for sounding boards. We have other people to help us out during times where there's a lot of stress or a lot of problems going on. So the extended family is very important to us. And my youngest son, he's an idealist, and he's a long way from getting married, I hope, is very clear on where things stand when he gets married, you know. And he was telling his Islamic studies teacher, yes, when I get married, my mother's going to live with us. And she says, but what if your wife doesn't like your mother? Well, then she's not going to be my wife. And he goes on and he explains to her, well, you see, she should like my mother because my mother is there to protect her rights. And then his Islamic studies teacher says, well, are you sure you want that? And he says, well, it's going to make my life hard, yeah. But he has a healthy attitude. He has the idea. He has an understanding of what it is, you know, to have the extended family and to maintain the support structure as it goes on. Now, divorce is allowed in Islam, but of all the things that are allowed, it's the thing that's hated the most. A man can declare divorce by saying, I divorce you three times during three different menstrual cycles, okay? But a woman can also obtain a divorce. During the time of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, divorces were granted for simple things like, in one case, the woman did not like the way her husband looked. And the divorce was granted because she just didn't like the way he looked. So the limitations on the woman by Islam, as far as being able to get a divorce, aren't there. But divorce is to be avoided. And before you go to divorce, you have to go through arbitration. And during the arbitration, the couple has to stay together. They have to continue trying to work out the problems. We don't just fly off and get divorced. It doesn't work that way, not amongst true Muslims. During the marriage, the woman's rights have been protected. Okay. It's said that when a Muslim marries, he perfects half of his religion, and that he should practice righteousness to secure the remaining half. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, marriage is my way. Whoso loves my conduct should follow my way, and who strays from my way is not for me. The family life of the Prophet is a unique example of affection and kindness and patience and forgiveness, of gentleness, of civility, patience. The married families of today could learn a lot by studying how he conducted himself in his marriage relations. Muhammad introduced a new dimension into the human relationship of man and woman, enriching the family with love, pleasure, comfort, mercy, and security, enabling them both to gain moral goodness and spiritual excellence through their relationship. So while the woman is protected during the marriage, and we try to avoid the divorce, her protection in case of divorce is not forgotten. The man cannot abuse the woman in order to make her seek divorce, because if she seeks divorce, she has to return a part of the dowry. He's forbidden to speak anything bad about her or to hold her in suspense. Okay, he has to either maintain his marriage relationship or he has to let her go. He can't just go away from her. He remains 100% financially responsible for the children, and in some instances, for his ex-wife. Now, this might be a good time for us to go in and talk a little bit about the woman in the workplace and the ERA, okay? ERA was struggling for equal pay. In 1939, a woman earned 63 cents to a man's dollar. 1985, she earned 64 cents to a man's dollar, a gain of a penny in almost 50 years. In 1987, 23% of all working women earned less than $10,000 a year at a full-time job. 80% of these women are heads of single-parent families. Now, the average child support that is awarded is $300 a month, but 60% of all of the divorced fathers contribute nothing to the care of their children. And this doesn't even take into account all of the children who have been fathered outside of marriages. These children have no rights. These mothers have no rights to assistance. This puts an unbelievable stress and strain upon the woman. And an ever-increasing number of our children are growing up in poverty. You have to realize that economic depravity of women is translated into a host of several problems for our children. We have failure or low achievement in school, child neglect, child abuse, drug use, crime, welfare dependency. Well, in Islam, it's ordered that we have equal pay. There's no difference between what a man earns and what a woman earns. The Quran says to give the worker their due before the sweat is dry on the brow. It doesn't say and pay the woman half of what the man earns. It's to be paid. Now, many Muslim women do choose not to work, and the Islamic social system makes that decision possible. Here, most women have lost something exceedingly important, because we've lost the freedom of choice. Women are forced into the 9-to-5 rut, sticking their children into child care systems and forcing themselves into stress and strain situations by trying to run a household, work a full-time job, be a mother, in some cases still even be a wife. And there's no time for themselves. They're burning out. Even many American women now are choosing to live a less expensive lifestyle and stay at home, because they're starting to recognize the damage this does to their children and to themselves. I have to cover very quickly two big subjects. Okay, we save them for last. One has to do with the hijab, the Islamic dress of the woman. Now, to many Western educated people, this is a sign of our oppression. This isn't so with a Muslim woman who has an understanding of Islam. This, to us, is our badge of honor. This is my right. This is my human right, to be able to wear this. This identifies me as being a Muslim. In this country, I do not have the freedom to dress the way I would like to. In this country, if I go out with the face veil, there's a few of you that haven't given up the face veil, and I applaud you for your courage. Because when we go out, we take a lot of problems. When I used to cover my face, I walked into a bank once to cash a check, and I walked into the bank and the guard hit the guns at his hips, you know. They really didn't know what to do with me. They did finally cash the check, but I had to go in the back room and show the lady my face, you know, before she would do it. But they were terrified of me. And I found that in just about everywhere I went, that people were antagonistic. Well, forget working a job with a face veil on. We can accept that that's impossible over here. You can't wear this much and get a job either. You can't wear this much and get a job and support yourself. It seems in this country, if we are to survive, because we don't have the Islamic social system that will support us and take care of us, the only way that we can survive is to bare ourselves. And this is, to us, a violation of our human rights. We would like to be able to maintain our dignity and maintain our dress. It's not oppressive to us. I'm very comfortable the way I am dressed. I don't want to wear less clothing, and it doesn't hinder me in any way. I ski, I sail, I horseback ride, I go camping, I go hiking, I climb trees with my grandchildren, I fly kites. I can do anything I want to dress the way I am, but it hurts my heart to see how frightened people are of me. And this brings us to this article. This article, what it has done, has increased people's fear, increased people's antagonism, increased their mistrust of us, increased their conviction that Islam is a religion for ignorant fools. It's making it very difficult for us. And now I have a sign here that says I have to finish quickly. And I didn't get a chance to hit on polygamy, so I'll have to deal with polygamy later. Okay, salaamu alaikum.
Thank you. Our next speaker, Deborah Scroggins, will give her statement. Again, I ask that you show her the same courtesy and respect that you did to Aminah Assilmi, and let her complete her statement without interruption. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you for having me here tonight. Well, I'm just going to start out with a little explanation of how the Atlanta Journal-Constitution decided to write the articles, and then talk a bit about what they said and some of the issues they raised. I've been reported traveling and writing about the Middle East for 12 years now, and I had spent a lot of time in Sudan, which has had a succession of Islamic governments, or at least governments that call themselves Islamic, and had become very interested in the situation of women. But what really piqued our interest was the Algerian elections last year. And what happened in Algeria, as probably most of you know, is that a Islamic party actually won the first round of national elections. And then the Algerian military cracked down and put a stop to the democratic experiment. And the Western governments and the military government that took its place in Algeria said that one of the reasons that they had, well, the army said the reason it had made the crackdown, and the Western government said they supported it because the Islamic National Salvation Front had intended to restrict the rights of women. And there had been a number of professional women's groups who had demonstrated against the Islamic Salvation Front. But when you actually looked at the election results, you found that a majority of Algerian women appeared to have voted for the front. So this raised the question in my mind, and the mind of my editors, of what exactly was happening in the Middle East. There seemed to be a paradoxical choice between democracy and what, at least in the West, would be perceived as women's rights. It seemed that if democracy, you know, if free and fair elections were to be held in many countries throughout the Middle East, there was a good chance that Islamic parties, political parties, would win, who would then try to restrict women's freedom of movement, and that women themselves, in large numbers, were supporting these movements. So that's what we set out to look at, the political movement that's sweeping the Middle East now. And so we went to four countries. The first one was Turkey, and what we were looking at there was Turkey has is one of the only countries that has a civil legal code there, but there is a burgeoning Islamic movement, and women are very active in it, and they would like to return to strict Islamic law, which in Turkey would mean giving up a lot of rights. So we spent time interviewing the most highly educated women, female professionals and students about their reasons for wanting to join that movement. Then we went on to Pakistan, where Pakistan since 1979 has had a set of Islamic, or what they consider to be, what the government claims are Islamic laws. And we wanted to look at how they were affecting women. The number of women who have been arrested under these laws has gone up from practically nothing to over 4,000. So we spent time there with that. Then we went on to Afghanistan just before the guerrilla takeover and spent time in an area controlled by one of the Islamic factions, Hezbollah. And just looking at the life which the guerrillas then planned to bring to Kabul, an area where women had a lot more freedom in their life. And then went on to Kuwait, where, as I'm sure many of you know, women at that time were trying to agitate to get the vote. Since then, they've had the elections without a female vote, and the Islamic parties had a big victory. So that's what the articles were about. We tried to pick two relatively liberal countries and two very conservative countries and look at that. Now, let me just go over some of the issues that what the Islamic political parties have in common. They have different interpretations of Sharia or Islamic law, but all of them, to make a sort of broad generalization, would like to bring back Islamic law and make it the law of the land, the law of the state. And those were the people that we were interested in. So not Islam as a personal choice, as it is for many people in the United States, but as this law, state law. And the way Sharia is interpreted by these groups raises a couple of questions. Okay, the first one is the fornication laws, called Zina laws in Pakistan. The fact that fornication becomes a crime against the state, first of all, you can get into a lot of issues about exactly how that law is interpreted, but the first thing that happens, has happened in Iran, has happened in Afghanistan, has happened in Sudan, Saudi Arabia, other countries, is the separation of men and women, which, to Western view at least, seems to raise a lot of inequalities between education, civil rights, women's and men's ability to associate freely with each other. Then more specifically, the question of women being able to testify in fornication laws or suits. In Pakistan, the rape laws and the fornication laws have been fused so that if a woman is raped, and she doesn't have four male witnesses to attest to the act, then if she goes to the authorities and reports it, she can be accused of fornication and thrown in jail herself. And both men and women, if they have four male witnesses, can theoretically be stoned to death, although the sentences haven't been carried out there. And on a lesser evidence, they can get up to 10 years in prison. Second legal provision that raises questions is the question of obedience. Now, there's some debate over exactly what the Quran says about whether men have a responsibility for women, are they superior, how exactly does one interpret those verses. But the way it has been interpreted in practical laws throughout the Middle East is to make women have a legal responsibility to be obedient to their husbands. And so that translates into, for example, laws in Sudan and Saudi Arabia that women in Iran, that women can't travel without permission from their husbands or their fathers or whoever their legal guardians, that their legal guardians can decide whether they're allowed to work, whether they're allowed to be educated abroad. Okay. Another question, which Aminah was going to talk about, but is polygamy. The fact that since this Islamic movement has begun, there had been some move to make polygamy more conditional in Pakistan and Iran and Sudan and Egypt. Since this has started, men's right to unilateral right to marry as up to four wives has been restored, while women don't have the same right. Same goes for divorce laws. Aminah says that there should be a period of waiting between the number of times that a man renounces his wife. That's not always the way it's been interpreted. For example, in Pakistan, a man can say it, you know, say it at once, and a woman would be divorced. Whereas a woman has to go to court or to an arbitration to be divorced. So that seems unfair. Then the question of inheritance. It's true that in the Islamic system, a man would have a legal responsibility to support the women in his family. But on the other hand, a lot of people here would argue that a more fair system, that a lot of women would prefer to have the independence of inheriting their own money rather than to be dependent on a brother or husband or a father. And then the fifth question, the question of hijab or veiling, something that's very controversial in the Middle East, and I'd have to agree completely with Aminah that women should have the right to dress in whatever way they please. And for example, in Turkey, one of the big debates is that women are not allowed to wear hijab in government institutions, and many people consider that a violation of their human rights, just as they consider it a violation of women's human rights in Iran, in Sudan, in Saudi Arabia, in other places where they are legally required to wear a veil, or in Afghanistan. So, those are some of the main issues that were raised in the articles, and those are some of the things that these political movements had focused on as far as women are concerned, and that's the topic.
All right, we've finished with the first part of tonight's format. Before we start the second part, I notice there are people standing at the back of the room. Again, if you came late, I would like to inform you that there is a hall immediately to my left with a projection screen, and you may go in there and sit down and you won't miss a thing, okay? I would also like to remind you that there will be a question and answer session coming up, and if you would like to submit a written question, please write it down and pass it to the person on the aisle, and someone from the MSA will be collecting those questions before that part of the debate starts. The second part of the debate consists of a discussion between the two speakers regarding certain issues which were discussed in the statements and were addressed in the Women of the Veil articles. I guess the logical place to start is with some of the five areas indicated in Ms. Scroggins' opening statements dealing with Sharia, Islamic law, and women. Specifically, I guess I would like to invite both speakers, and maybe I will ask Aminah Assilmi to go first, regarding what the Islamic viewpoint is on women's testimony, men's testimony, and the fornication law situation in Pakistan.
It's true that the Zina law of Pakistan is as she described it. It's also true that it's not Islamic. Okay, in the Quran, it gives very clear guidance, and just a second. Let me get my glasses so I can read. To the reporter earlier, and now I can't find it right like this. Okay, basically it states that in the Quran that if there are not four witnesses, that the man can testify four times, and on the fifth time that he can ask the wrath of God Okay? But then after that, the woman is given the same opportunity, and if she bears witness four times and then on the fifth, as the wrath of God, that she's declared innocent. Now that's what it says in the Quran itself. And so that's what has to apply. In this instance, the woman's testimony is stronger than what her husband's testimony is. The fact that there are all of these women in the prisons in Pakistan cannot be denied. And the International Union of Muslim Women is working on this, but we face a very big problem in that we're having to educate the masses a little bit about Islam. And we can't just change the law, we're also going to have to make provisions for the women that are in the prisons, because we can't send them back to their families, because their families have not been educated and do not have the knowledge and the understanding, and they would do injury to them, and we know this. So while I'm standing here and telling you about Islam, it's Islam the ideal. It's not what's being practiced in Pakistan or any other place. These are cultural horrors, if you will, and the situation for the women when it comes to this is definitely a horror.
Would you like to make any comment?
Well, maybe I could ask a question.
Okay.
It's true that Pakistan does have a peculiar, specific set of laws, but on the larger issue of the fornication laws as they should be, and the question of segregation of men and women, do you think that that should be a legal obligation of the state?
Okay, fornication and adultery are not personal, all right? They are crimes against society, because they affect the entire family and the entire community. Adultery can be the cause of divorce. Fornication can be the cause of children who have no legal rights, who have no parents. These are crimes against society. Mm. These are not, the way they're accepted here, it's like, yo, it's nothing, okay, you go to bed, whatever, okay, it's just not, this isn't reality. Bad things come out of fornication, bad things come out of adultery, and they affect other people, not just the one person. So you have to be held accountable. You don't sacrifice all of society's rights for individual rights. There has to be a balance between individual and society. If you gotta have sex, you gotta get married. As simple as that.
Well, what would you think about...
Wait a minute. In Islam, all praise is for Allah, and I really ask you not to applaud anything that I say. If there's anything, please, you know, the praise is for Allah.
Well, what sort of measures, what do you think about some of the measures that have been taken in certain Islamic countries to keep men and women separate to prevent any sort of fornication or adultery from happening? You know, we can go through examples if you'd like.
Well, I don't think that absolute separation has any necessary place, because the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ate with women that he wasn't married to. He ate from the same pot with them. He met and talked with them. He taught them. The total segregation actually comes from cultures outside of Islam, and it isn't necessary. Okay, that carries it too far. I agree to that. But the absolute total free mixing, this also is not necessary. If we're dealing with men on a level of business, on a level of education, on a level of profession, as a doctor or as a nurse or as a teacher or as a lawyer or whatever, that's one thing. But in the social mixing, with things like dancing and with a lot of other things that go on with social mixing, now again you're running into areas that can definitely cause problems. Very few women, if they were really being truthful, could say that if they saw their husband across a crowded room in a deep conversation with a voluptuous, beautiful woman in a skimpy gown that she wouldn't have pangs of jealousy and suspicion. Very few really truthful men could say that if they saw their wives across a crowded room talking with a hunk that could compete with Adonis, that they wouldn't have some serious pangs of jealousy that could lead to suspicion. Jealousy is like a disease, and it grows, and it leads to serious problems in serious relationships. So absolute free mingling, there's not any need for it.
So you would support, you think that it is the role of the state to step in and prevent those sort of encounters?
Yes, I do.
Let me ask a follow-up question. One of the things, Sister, that you discussed in your opening statement was that men and women are different, but this does not affect their equality. To a Westerner, if he hears that, he thinks, well, if they're saying that they're different, then they have to, by definition, be not the same and are therefore in some manner unequal. How do you respond to the line of questioning that unless you treat them the same, they are in fact not equal?
Well, same and equal aren't the same. Even if you read in Webster, the definition in Webster for same and equal would not be the same. Same means without difference. And vive la difference. Men and women are different. Apples and oranges are different. Cats and dogs are different. It doesn't mean that one is less important than the other, that one has less value than the other. It just means that they're different. And the Quran states that we still have the same obligations. We have the same punishment for a crime. We have the same chance of getting into heaven. We have the same reward for the same deed done. There's no difference in the eyes of Allah. But to eat an orange, you peel it. To eat an apple, you don't.
Do you have any questions?
Well, I think that there's, you know, as we've gone over, I mean, there's certain areas of the law where women are clearly treated differently, and I would argue that, I mean, we had a debate in this country over separate but equal. Is that possible? And, you know, obviously I would side on the error to the side that they're treated differently under the law, and therefore it's not the same, and it's not equal. Men have certain rights that women don't.
Okay. My next question, the next area that I'd like to address is in your article, by the way, most of you may not know that the article Women of the Veil, which appeared in the Milwaukee Journal, is actually a condensation of approximately 12 pages of newspaper articles down to 2 pages in the Milwaukee Journal. I would like to ask what kind of research and what kind of persons you talk to gain the understanding of Islam and Islamic law, which are contained in your article?
Well, as I said, I've been covering the Middle East and writing about it for some time, but on this particular trip, we specifically tried to talk to political leaders, ordinary people who were affected by the laws, women who were active on both sides of the issues, lawyers. And why did we do that rather than, say, talking to Islamic scholars is a question that I've been asked a lot. And although I did try to read that and talk to some of them, but the reason was because we were not interested in trying to establish, you know, the question that people have asked for 1,400 years, you know, what is Islam, how should it be? That wasn't our question at all. It was, how is it being interpreted in certain countries right now, today? You know, how about this political movement that is actually in the Middle East today? What are they trying to do, and why are they trying to do it, and how are people responding to it? So that, for example, there's a lot of things that I talk about in the articles, like, for example, different types of veiling, where, you know, people from another country will argue that Afghanistan is far too strict, it's not required by Islam, it's, you know, and their kind of total strict separation of the sexes is going too far, but too many Afghans, that is Islam, that's how they interpret it. So that's what we were interested in looking at, you know, how were people on the spot interpreting these laws.
Okay, would you recognize that there's a distinction to be made between Islam as it is contained in the Quran and the tradition of the Prophet and how different cultures may be interpreting it today?
Well, sure. I mean, absolutely. I mean, there's, you know, a billion Muslims in the world. Everyone is going to have a different interpretation of Islam and what it is and what the Quran actually says. But there are some common areas, and like I said, why I was not looking at the Quran and, you know, are these people interpreting it right or wrong, but instead just saying, here's how they are interpreting it now, and here's where they derive it from, where they get their legitimacy from in the Quran. Whether they've done that correctly or not is a different matter.
Could I ask Sister Assilmi to comment on how different cultures have interacted with Islam?
Well, I'll be one of the first to admit that I see a lot of cultural pollution in Islam. And it's very distressing, not only to me, but to everyone else, because the cultural pollution is one of the things that keeps the Muslims from coming together. The thing about it is that in spite of the cultural pollution, no matter where someone is from, I can take this book and I can sit them down and I can say, okay, you do that in your country, but explain to me, why does it say this here? And 9 times out of 10, they come back and they will change what they were saying, because here we have the word of God, the word of Allah, and all of the Muslims, no matter where they're from, are willing to accept this. And this was what we took before the parliament 1.5 years ago in Pakistan and presented these ayahs regarding zina that they had to accept, they couldn't argue with. And it's these ayahs, this book, that will get those laws changed. Whether or not cultures are practicing things wrong or not is, to me in this case, almost irrelevant. If we were writing about the cultural practices of Catholics in Central America, or in Peru, or in Africa, or in Italy, or wherever, it would be listed as the practices of a particular country, and being Catholic would never come into it, in spite of what they do being done by their interpretation of Catholicism. But whatever any Muslim does is, by our media, laid on all of us. And that's my objection. And if someone's going to write about Islam, you can look and talk to whoever you want to, and you can find somebody to say anything. We did an experiment in one community where we invited 13 different scholars into our community, and each time we had someone meet with them and lead them towards feeling that the community was a certain way, and we got all kinds of different verdicts on the issue that we put forward to them. You can find people to give whatever answer. But this is something different. And so, like, the issue of whether a woman could testify or not in Pakistan should have been said that, but then just reading these two verses of the Quran would have made it very clear that it's not Islamic to do that. And it distresses me that people of other religions in other countries, it's never put on their religion. It's not blamed on their religion. But with us, everything is blamed on our religion. And that people want to look at us through their eyes, they don't want to look at us through our eyes and see how we see ourselves and see what we are feeling and what we are thinking. I am an American. I am a Muslim. And I want people to know what Islam is. And I want people to accept me as a human being, as a Muslim, in my hijab. But if journalists continue writing things that make people think that Muslims are ignorant fools for being Muslim, then I can't blame you guys for looking at me and giggling and snickering as I'm walking down the hallway in my abaya. I can't blame you. If I weren't a Muslim, if I didn't understand the way I look, then I might laugh at myself too. I mean, walking in here,
When I first walked in, I walked past a group of students, and one of them almost fell on the floor laughing. He'd probably never seen anyone dressed like me. But that hurts. That's offensive. It doesn't make me insecure, but it's offensive and it hurts because my rights are being impended on. And one of the things that helps this is the way people present Islam all the time.
I will just raise one more issue before proceeding to the question and answer period with the audience. That issue has to do with the quotes from the Quran which are contained in the Women of the Veil series. My question to Deborah Scroggins is for the quotations from the Quran which were contained in the series. What translation did you choose and why did you choose it?
It's the Dawood, it's the Penguin translation. Perfectly, simply, it's paperback. It was for sale in Pakistan. I bought it, you know. I had a smaller book called The Social Laws of the Quran, and then I found out that I really wasn't going to be able to get by with that. I needed to read the entire Quran, so that was the one that I bought. Just happened to be no particular reason.
Okay.
Just happened to be the one.
Sister, you read some of these passages quoting or translating the Quran contained in the Women of the Veil articles. Do you believe that those quotations contained in those articles are accurate?
They're probably accurate according to him. It's kind of beneficial if you know, when you're looking at a book on a particular subject, that you find someone who is knowledgeable of the particular subject, preferably when it comes to religion that they're practicing. I know that all over the world, and I chose to bring this one, I have 17 different translations, but this is the Yusuf Ali, and I know that this is the one that is read a great deal in Pakistan, but not as much as the Maududi, which I also have. And those would have been much better, and I think if she had read one of those instead of the one by this guy who's he's an Arab, but he's not a Muslim. It states so in the book. At the beginning of the book, it states that he is an Arab, but not a Muslim. And he does have, when I first reviewed the book, I advised against it because of the fact that he has ayats mixed up and he has things that are just way off the wall. Because I can take any of my 17 translations and read the same ayats and come back with pretty close to the same thing, just a change in a word here or there. Except for when you get into like this. So I don't blame Deborah for that one, except that I wish she had read in the front of the book that he was who he was, and then she might not have chosen that one.
Okay, that concludes the second part of tonight's program. The third and final part of the debate will consist of a question and answer session. Again, questions may be submitted in writing to the moderator, that's me, and people are going to be collecting them in the aisles. We have quite a few already. In addition to that, we are going to be taking questions from the microphones, and I also may call on some people if they raise their hand, but I have a feeling that that's going to get a little bit out of control. So I would request that you do make your way to microphone if you do want to ask a question from the floor. I have quite a few questions here. I'll try to do the best that I can to read through these as I go along and sort them out. Realizing that you are not educated with the truth and facts of Islam, I would hope you would have the reasoning to distinguish between what is tradition and the fact of what Islam is and what is cultural practices mistaken for Islam. And in particular, there is a reference to the mutilation of women's private parts as an Islamic tradition contained within the Women of the Veil series versus a cultural tradition. The question is, I guess the question would be stated, is that practice limited to your knowledge only to Muslims? Is that practice limited to particular countries? What is your information on that practice?
Okay, just like I wrote in the series, It's not an Islamic practice. It's a pre-Islamic practice that appears to have originated in the Nile Valley and spread across Africa and parts of the Middle East, parts of Malaysia and Indonesia. What I was said in the article is that in Sudan, Somalia, and Egypt, where the countries that I mentioned there might have included Mali too, people justify it on the basis of religion, and they consider it a part of religion. They even call one of the particular operations Sunnah, because they believe that it's the way of the Prophet, and they have a hadith that they use to justify it by. Now, as I pointed out in the articles, all Islamic scholars, including many there, say that it is definitely not part of religion, and I've seen, anyway, so I did point that out in the article, but in those countries, people believe that this is a practice that is either ordained or at least considered to be a bonus in the Islamic religion. Now, as to where it's practiced, there's more than 100 million women across Africa. There's Christians, Jews, traditional African religions that all practice genital mutilation. However, the most severe form, infibulation, is only preserved in four countries: Mali, Somalia, Sudan, and parts of Ethiopia. And some scholars do argue that Nigeria, I should add that too, parts of it. Anyway, some scholars do argue, and I'm just repeating this, this wasn't in the articles, but that the Islamic emphasis on chastity has helped preserve that custom. Now, just throw that out.
Sister, your comment on whether the practice of mutilation of female private parts is an Islamic tradition, or whether it's just limited to Muslims in certain areas of the world?
It absolutely has nothing to do with Islam. In fact, it's absolutely prohibited in Islam, and that's why it's decreasing. As people are becoming more educated about Islam, this practice is decreasing in Muslim countries. Deborah stated it very clearly that it's practiced all across Africa primarily, and it crosses borders of all religions. Even some of the Christian religions, they still practice this. It's, I think, in all of those places, just like amongst the Muslim countries where it is still practiced, it's a matter of education. But as we are educating the Muslims, teaching them how to read, teaching them how to write so they can read the Quran for themselves rather than accept it from somebody else, this is a practice that will be abolished before long.
Okay, I'll take a question down front here to my left.
My comment and question is for Ms. Deborah. Reading your article, I didn't find that it was objective journalistic article. I mean, it's obvious that it's more of a subjective one, and it's more of an attack on the ideology of Islam itself, instead of describing the situation that has been a result of the colonialist era that has been that controlled the area, the Middle Eastern area especially, or the Muslim world for the past century. So I would have it would have been more journalistic or more objective if your article even addressed the situation over there as the result of the colonialist era in the Middle East. It is not the result of Islam, because Islam has not been implemented there for the past century. And Islam is not to be defended, because it's an ideology that presented the world a new way of life. So I would like you to comment on that, and I would have suggested that your article should have been written under the name of not Muslim, a woman in veil, someone in veil. It should have been the situation of countries that has been subjected to the control of the colonialistic powers in the past century. Thank you.
Well, I'm sorry you feel that way. The question of whether I should have emphasized more the influence that the colonial period has played on current developments in the Islamic world now, well, it's a judgment call. I mean, many people would argue, you know, that Islam 100 years ago was not practiced correctly. So, I mean, you could get into an argument about that. I mean, there are people who argue that it hasn't been practiced correctly since the time of
Omar. But what I was looking at is how are people interpreting Islam as laws, and what I mean by that is states now, and how are families interpreting it and enforcing it within their families, and they didn't see it as something having to do with colonialism. In fact, they saw it as getting away from colonialism, so that's the way I reported it.
Okay, a couple more written questions. The first one is to Ms. Scroggins, what religion are you?
Well, I'm raised a Catholic. I call myself a very secular person now.
All right. Question for, another question for Ms. Scroggins. What rights will women lose if Islamic movements, I assume the questioner is asking about Islamic fundamentalist movements, took over the governments in some of the countries? I suppose that would be in comparison as to what rights they had before.
In which countries?
They specify any countries, or in some of the countries you mentioned in your introduction.
Well,
let me just repeat the question again. What rights will women lose if Islamic fundamentalist movements took over governments in some of those countries as compared to what rights they have right now under those existing governments?
Well, let's see. Well, I mean, it's hard to say since they haven't done it yet, but in Algeria, for example, one of the things that the Islamic Salvation Front had campaigned on, and they shifted back and forth, but they said that they were going to try to get women to leave the workplace and open up the jobs for men, saying that men and women shouldn't be working together. That was one clear example of something that might have happened if they had taken power. On the other hand, it's a moral issue. They were democratically elected, so a lot of people would say they should have been left in power. And I do want to make one point, that it's not always that Islamic governments, that women are going to be losing rights. Let's take the situation of Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, there was, and this is common in an extreme form in Afghanistan to a lot of Islamic countries, there is an elite in the cities of women who were had some educated, they worked together with men, they went to school, they wore whatever they liked. These people lost a lot of their freedom when the Islamic government came in. However, an argument can be made that there are female Islamic activists who are now going around and trying to teach the rural Afghan men that it's not against the Quran, but in fact is required by the Quran for women to have education. And that in the long run, if they can keep up that, they may uplift women more than any secular government could have done, because they never would have been accepted by the rural population. So it works both ways. And, you know, more women are working today in Iran than were before the revolution, than in any other Middle Eastern country. So it works both ways. On the other hand, women in Iran have lost some of their rights in marriage. They've lost their ability to enter certain careers. They're segregated much more from men than they were before. They've lost the ability to study abroad without special permission. So anyway, those are some examples.
Sister Assilmi, do you have any belief as to whether women would experience a net gain or loss of rights if an Islamic fundamentalist government came into power in some country in the Middle East?
I think that would depend on the fundamentalist government. I think in Algeria, the women would have gained, you know, from listening to what the plans were, because the women are being educated more, and the fact that more of the women would be encouraged to stay at home. You know, by our standards, a woman, in order to be of value, has to be outside the home, okay? By the values of the Muslim women, being a wife and being a mother is the very highest profession there is, because we're raising the next generation. And I think you would find that most of the Muslim women in Algeria would not object to being able to stay at home. Many of the women had actually been forced to start working because of the government that was there in the past. And they look forward to the opportunity to stay home and be wives and mothers.
Okay, question down front and in the right.
Okay, I'm Tom McKillen, a writer for the UBM Times. I've also have some knowledge about the Muslim faith, dealing with some workers. I've worked with some of the food service jobs here. Just like to toss an impression out, and that's this. The key conflict here seems to be that the questions or points that were brought up in Ms. Scroggins' articles upset many Muslims in this country, because this country is, you know, fairly provincial. It's you know, there's not much knowledge of anything outside this country, much less what within this country. And at a time you're trying to teach people of this country about what Islam is, there's this criticism coming, and which is all out of context, and people can't tell the difference between cultural and religious. You know, what is Islam as a religion? What is the culture of the country? And what do these laws, where do these laws actually deviate from? Is that a correct statement?
I think it's an enormous simplification. Some of the statistics are valid. Some of the statistics, I mean, you can find statistics to prove all kinds of things. Okay, there are more women PhDs in Pakistan than there are in the United States. More women PhDs. Okay, so the illiteracy rate is also very high in Pakistan. That's because they did not have, in the past, education for the masses, and it's something that's being changed. The article needed to, if it was going to be put under the name of Islam, it needed to have been a little bit more open. Okay, the International Union of Muslim Women is very prominent in Pakistan. The women in Pakistan that are members of this organization are on the parliament, and their husbands hold very high positions and their husbands hold very low positions. And had she had an opportunity to meet with any of those women, which I don't know why she didn't, her eyes would have been open to a lot that's going on in Pakistan that isn't presented here, like the way the public education system is now being developed, like the healthcare, national healthcare system that's starting to be implemented. Have to remember that this country, we got our independence over 200 years ago. Pakistan has had its independence about 50 years. It's still going through a lot of growing pains. Other countries, most so-called Muslim countries, have had their independence a lot less time, and they're still working out their identities. And this is something that's not taken into consideration. If you're going to talk from a cultural level, you have to talk about the trauma of establishing an identity. And the article left too much said and not enough said. It just seemed to leave an ugly taste in people's mouth towards Muslims and towards Islam, and feeling very sorry for any poor, ignorant woman who would embrace Islam as their way of life. And that was very hurtful.
Do you have any comment you'd like
to make?
Well,
I would just disagree. I would say that if anything, if it would arouse any sort of sympathy, I think it would arouse sympathy for people who are having religious laws forced upon them that they didn't ask for, and they're being forced to live according to.
Okay, a few more written questions for Sister Aminah. Do you consider yourself a scholar in Islamic law and religion?
I consider myself to be a Muslim who's struggling constantly to increase my knowledge. I don't consider myself a scholar. Other people do, but I don't consider myself a scholar because I don't think I know near enough at this time, and will probably never know as much as I feel that I need to know and as much as I want to know about Islam. Scholar is, that's a term that has different meanings to different people. So I don't call myself a scholar. I practice Islam, and I try to make it as much a part of my life as I can, and I study and I research and I question, because Islam taught me to question.
Same question is asked for Ms. Scroggins. Do you consider yourself an expert on Islamic law and religion?
No.
Ms. Scroggins, you quoted individuals who you described as, quote, Muslim feminists, unquote, including Fatima Mernissi and Nawal al-Sa'dawi. Do you consider it ethical for you as a journalist to quote individuals on Islam without indicating that these individuals are opposed to Islam because they advocate a completely different political system, namely socialism? Is it not usual for a journalist to cite the bias of people she quotes?
Well, those are two different people. Nawal al-Sadawi, as I wrote in the article, is arguing for what she believes would be a truly Islamic socialism. I'm not commenting on whether, you know, other people agree with her that that would be Islamic in any way, but that's what she thinks. And Fatima Mernissi has just come out with a book. I wish I'd had a chance to talk more about it in the articles, but anyway, and she's really looking at the sources of Islam and at the Prophet's life and trying to show that the way Islamic laws have been interpreted over the centuries is really not the way he intended it for women. But they consider themselves to be Muslims and their theories to be Islamic theories, so I'm just accepting that on their own terms.
Another question for you is, my question has to do with the skewed picture you gave of Islamic society based on the few observations you made. Do you think it would be fair if a journalist from Pakistan or another country came to the United States and interviewed women in prison, women at shelters for battered women, women who had been abused sexually and so on, and then tell her readers that this was the position of women in the United States?
Well, first of all, yes. I mean, I do think it'd be fine if a Pakistani or any other journalist wanted to come and interview anyone in the United States and write whatever they like. Do I think it would be fair? Do I think it would be accurate? I think that if they did what I did and they tried to interview women of all different social classes, women who were in prison, out of prison, highly educated, less educated, and you know, then they might come away with a fair picture. And I always thought, it's interesting, when I was writing the articles, in my mind, I could always imagine a sort of mirror set of articles, and I could imagine what some of the women I had met would be writing about the United States and the way that they would look at our society very differently, and they could take almost exactly the same issues and look at the way our laws treat women or men and have a totally different opinion about, you know, whether that was good or bad. But I think it'd be great if they did that.
There's another question in here. I don't have it right in front of me, but do you believe it would be fair for that person from Pakistan, in this hypothetical question, to entitle the article Women Under Christianity then?
Well, it's not entitled Women Under Islam. It's entitled Women of the Veil, and the reason, it's not actually not my choice of a title, but the reason that my editors chose it is because they felt that the veil was such an issue that was associated today in the Middle East with the fundamentalist movement, the Islamic political movement, the Islamic revival. But no, as I've said before, I mean, it wasn't intended to show a picture of how women live under Islam, but to show how the political Islamic movement is affecting women.
Okay. We'll take a question from the woman at the microphone in the upper left-hand corner.
It's not a question, it's a comment in regards to female mutilization. It was presented in Deborah Scroggins' articles. I read all 12 pages, as well as the two pages that appeared in the journal, that this was a practice that was imposed upon women who were either Muslims or in the East or from the continent of Africa. I would like for the audience to know that this is something that was done to women in Europe, in the United States of America. It's a documented that you can find in a book called Sisterhood is Global, as well as many others. And I would like for people to go away knowing that this isn't something that is ascribed to women who were Muslims. Sister Aminah has quite clearly brought it to our attention that it wasn't anything that was Sunnah. I would also like to say to Ms. Scroggins and the other women in the audience that those atrocities that have been inflicted upon women is something that we feel very strongly about from the Muslim community, and it is something that we wouldn't want to be imposed upon any woman, but we also do not want anything to be assigned to Islam when it is not Islamic. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. A couple. If a first wife is opposed to a husband's second marriage, can or does it still take place? How common are multiple marriages, and how are they able to be kept fair? Is this even possible? I guess maybe you want to briefly discuss the issue of polygamy under Islam.
the reason I had saved polygamy for the end anyway was because to fully discuss polygamy takes about 3 hours to get into everything. So a little synopsis. I'll go ahead and try and answer this question. In Islam, a woman does not have a right to deny her husband or any other Muslim something that is permitted in Islam. So no, a woman cannot say under any circumstances to her husband, you can't take another wife. However, also, the man is supposed to do everything in mutual consultation with his wife, and he has to recognize that according to the Quran, that if this second marriage is going to make his first wife really unhappy, she does have the right for a divorce. That's the only right that she does have as far as that is to divorce her husband if he insists on taking the second wife. There's also a little further thing that talks about the curse on the person who comes between a man and his wife. So polygamy is definitely permissible. Polygamy serves a very definite, positive social need when it's practiced according to Islam. But polygamy is also very strongly regulated by Islam. It had never been really regulated before. It was just any old way you wanted to do it. Islam really regulated the polygamy, and the Quran mentions to the man that he must be just between them, and he says in the same ayat, he warns him that you can't. But then there's forgiveness as long as the man is trying his very best. Inshallah, there will be a small book coming out called Making It Together, which you might enjoy reading. It's a guidebook to the successful practice of polygamy. And it's due out 9 months from now. So inshallah, you'll enjoy it.
Question from down front here and left.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum.
My question to Ms. Scroggins, were you driven to write this article because you were instructed by your superiors, or because you were always a defender of the women's rights in this country? And if so, have you been writing always about the woman in general? And is also, if so, have you been writing about the rapes that going on the streets of every city in the United States, and about the even recent disturbing news that we've all heard about the rape of little girls here in this very city and the pornography that was going on for 10 years. Those need articles to be written on. Or were you driven by, because you care about the Muslim woman? And if so, how many pages you wrote about the rapes of the woman in Bosnia?
Question, you know.
Well, first of all, it was my idea. It wasn't my editor's idea, although they were enthusiastic about the idea because they had gotten curious about this issue during the Gulf War, during the driving protest in Saudi Arabia. Yeah. That's right. So anyway, they were curious about it, but it was my idea. Have I written about women before in this country? Yes, certainly. As a political reporter in this country, I've covered, you know, the usual issues: rape, abortion, family issues, family law, crime against women, just the same as every other reporter would.
I'll just follow up with one other question, which was wrapped in there. There was a question as to whether you wrote out of a concern for Muslim women, or you wrote out of what would have to be labeled a feminist perspective, or whether you wrote out of some other perspective.
No, I would consider it completely out of concern. I wouldn't describe it as, but I don't want to make it seem like it's some sort of patronizing type of concern, because one of the things that I tried the hardest to do there was to meet women who were actually supporting these movements to try to understand. I mean, that I knew already plenty of women in Sudan and in Egypt who were against the Islamic movement. I was, what was new to me about this trip was meeting women who supported and trying to learn why they did. So.
Let me follow up, because that's one of these written questions. How many, in gathering your research for your series of articles, did you seek out true women of the veil who were happy to be Muslims and hold no pains in their hearts about their religion? Did you speak with many of those people in writing your article?
Sure, I did. And like, I'd like to stress again, everyone in the articles is Muslim. I mean, there's not one person quoted in there who isn't. And so they're all, as far as I know, happy to be Muslim too. But they do have different interpretations, and some of them are very opposed to what some of these political parties are calling Islam.
Okay, speaker at the microphone in the upper right-hand corner. Please more directly into the mic.
The mic question is to both the speakers. Yeah, when I was indirect, I was, what do you call, very, anyhow. My question is to both the speakers. In the recent history, it is seen all over the world that a number of Christian priests, preachers, and bishops are arrested, prosecuted, and imprisoned in the sex scandals. Do you think anyone who does not know much about Christianity can draw a conclusion that there is something wrong with Christianity?
Yeah.
My question is to both the speakers, please.
Well, I'll go. You're talking about the child abuse cases, mostly priests. Well, I have heard an argument made, sure, here and also in the Middle East, that, you know, the Catholic Church's requirement of celibacy either attracts people who have unusual ideas, perhaps, or want to be in proximity with children in a position of authority, and that this helps create these situations. Sure, people can argue that. In fact, a lot of Protestants, you know, consider it to be entirely, you know, wrong for the Catholic Church to require its priests to be celibate. So, sure, I mean, people do talk about whether their religious beliefs are somehow kind of contributing to this problem.
Well, I do know from traveling and from talking with Muslims in other countries and with non-Muslims in other countries that, yeah, some of them are getting the idea that maybe it's the church, but I find that more people related to a sickness in this country that's caused by the idea of individual freedom and individual rights above social and society rights. So I find more people attribute that to our governmental system rather than to a religion.
Upper left-hand mic, please.
The word fundamentalism has been used many a times in this talk and also used in the publications. For the last 10, 11 years, I have been asked people in Middle East, in the Europe and United States, what is Islamic fundamentalism? Nobody defines anything. So I had to look at the publications and drive my own definition, which turns out to be something like this. The people who are believers, who wants to pray five times a day, fast in the month of Ramadan, and go for Hajj, and they want to live a life of a Muslim according to Quran and the way of Prophet Muhammad, they are the fundamentalists. And those who call themselves Muslims get drunk, eat pork, go for dancing, and go for fornication and all kind of evil society, they are wonderful, moderate Muslims. We love them. Isn't it the case, Ms. Scroggins?
No. No, although, well, anyway, my definition of fundamentalist that I would use as a journalist and my newspaper's definition as they use it is somebody who wants to make Sharia the law of the state. Somebody who has a political, whose political view is that Islam should be the political system governing their country. What they do, you know, otherwise. But it's true, as you say, that quite often there is an elite in these countries that's very unobservant, and they're often called the moderates or so on, whereas a lot of Muslims might regard them as just not being Muslim. But anyway, that's my definition of fundamentalist, the political definition.
Do you have a definition of Islamic fundamentalism?
Actually, my definition would have to include fundamentalism no matter what, okay? A fundamentalist is somebody who is trying to get back to the fundamentals, to the basics. And in these days and times, whether you're a fundamentalist Southern Baptist or a fundamentalist Muslim or anything else, people look down on you. The fundamentalist Baptists are really trying to get back to a very strict interpretation of the Bible, and they're drawing a lot of flack all across the country because they're standing in opposition to homosexuality, and they're doing it very openly because of what they read in the Bible, and they're getting into a lot of problems. So a fundamentalist is simply somebody who wants to get down to the basics. They want to get down to the nitty-gritty, and they want to apply it to their life.
Down front here and on my left.
This question is for the sister. There are obviously women who are born into Muslim families. I'm sure there are men too, who do not wish to practice Islam. And it appears they're being persecuted for it, and in some cases killed. Is this true? And if so, how do you propose to handle, or what should be done with women who are born into these families who do not want to wear the covering, or who do not want to abide by the laws of your religious book? My other question is, you spoke of the jealousy that a man or a woman may feel across the room when they see their husband talking to another woman. Well, to bring that other woman into the home as a second wife, wouldn't that just create a lot more jealousy and cause terrible problems? And why aren't women allowed to do this? I'm not saying they should be. I don't think anyone should be allowed to. But it seems very unfair.
Okay, in reality, there are not very many. I'm not going to say there are none. I will say I have never met a girl who was born into a Muslim family that did not want to practice Islam. That does not mean that they necessarily want to wear the head covering, mm-hmm. okay? They're not killed if they don't wear the head covering, all right? Mm-hmm. By Islamic law, it says that there's no compulsion in religion. Now, my children know they have free choice. If they want to choose another religion, they can. They know my heart would be devastated, but there's no compulsion in religion. It rarely happens, you know, alhamdulillah, it rarely happens. But if they kill them for it, then they make a mistake. The only time you're allowed to kill someone is when they renounce Islam and then fight against Islam.
But okay. Isn't there something going on where if a woman does dishonor to the family, there is a meeting and they can be killed? I've seen this in the news, and if it is wrong, and if it is propaganda, and if it's not true, then we should know about that.
It is not part of Islam, and there are many things that happen that Muslims may do, just there are many things that happen that Christians may do that are against their religion, okay? There have been instances I've read about, but I've never met anybody. I'll be truthful with you. But it's not Islamic to kill them because it says in the Quran that there's no compulsion in religion. On the other subject, which gets into polygamy, the woman across the crowded room, that one might steal your husband, okay? Because in a society where a man can only have one wife and you have more women than men, and statistics prove that this is a fact, okay, then you're in more danger of losing your husband to another woman. But if you're sharing your husband, that's something totally different.
So
there's no danger of that woman taking your husband away from you.
So you're saying the first wife would not feel jealousy or feel pain if another woman actually came into her house?
Not when it's done right. In the research for the book, I interviewed over 360 polygamous family units, mm-hmm. Both those that were not successful and those that were successful. And I found that the ones that were doing everything strictly according to Islam were absolutely wonderful family units. My first experience with polygamy was
right at the time when I became a Muslim. And I had this friend, Abdurrahman. He was a classmate of mine, and he invited me to dinner. And I met his wife, and we got along very well. And then a couple of days later, I met him at the grocery store, and he was with his wife. And, well, she seemed to have shrunk a little bit and gained some weight. And, but, you know, they all look the same in the black, you know, so the white scars. But anyway, the way it worked out was later on, I found out that these women were so much like sisters and so happy with each other, and that the first wife had chosen the second wife, and the second wife and the first wife together chose number three, and the three of them chose number four, and he never got a choice in the matter. Okay, it's a matter of the way it's dealt with.
I've been told that I'm supposed to finish the last question or ask the last question at 9:15. So unless we get a reprieve, I really want to move it now for the last few questions. Upper right, please.
I'd like to address this question to Ms. Scroggins. Don't you think that the Muslim justification for implying or imposing religious law is that this earth is God's kingdom, He is the supreme sovereign, and thus the state is only a vicar of God on earth, and thus imposing law is just pledging your allegiance to God, and that those who are opposed are truly not educated in religion, and that thus a fundamentalist like Sister Assilmi says is just a pious person?
How do you respond to that argument?
Well, I'm glad that you raised that issue. I mean, it gets to really the heart of the debate in the Middle East and the Islamic world today. I'm aware that a lot of Muslims believe that, some people say that anyone who really is pious will have to follow that interpretation. But there's another point of view which says any time you have a legal system with which there can be no dissent, which is believed to be divine, then you're going to run into problems, because what people do disagree. And they disagree over how it should be interpreted. And so anytime you can set yourself above me and tell me that you know the divine law and therefore I have no right to say anything about it, there's an inherent conflict there between a truly democratic system. And that's a choice that people have to face.
Upper right, please. Upper left, sorry.
I'd like to make a comment and then ask a question, because when the issue was raised about striking the woman in Islam and that it's written in the Quran, I watched several of the non-Muslims in the audience look at each other in horror. So when it was brought up in Ms. Scroggins' article, I can just imagine what people thought at home. So what I'd like to ask Ms. Scroggins is that when you brought this issue up, did you keep in mind that Islam, that the Quran was written 1400 years ago, at a time when pre-Islamic Arabia, which means that at that time there were the Christians and the Jews, were practicing female infanticide. They were considering the woman to be subhuman, less than human, and that Islam came and raised women above that level. Also, about the issue of striking women in Islam, I'd like to bring up the point that in Islam there are several steps that come before this gesture. First of all, this isn't a physical strike, this is more a gesture. First of all, there's the issue of reprimanding the wife or bringing up the issue. There's an opportunity to discuss the issue with her family. There's also an opportunity for a separation where they separate their beds, which would be common in many instances when people when a family has a problem, before resorting to this issue. And one issue you also did not raise is that whereas the man can take the gesture to strike the woman, if the husband did something to the wife, she can call her whole damn family. So it's equal. It's equal. It's not an issue. It's not he can strike her and this poor Muslim woman has to sit there. And also, when you brought this issue up, I'd like to know that as a reporter that's trying to bring forth understanding and comparison for the lay individuals, the non-Muslim individuals, did you say that, yes, I took a survey and found that so many Muslim men strike their family, as opposed to, please tell me, how many American men abuse sexually and physically not only their wives, but their girlfriends and their daughters and their sisters and their mothers. So this is an issue that I really wish that if you were really looking for understanding and promoting understanding between the religions and the races, I definitely think you would have brought up that issue.
Of course, you know, non-Muslim men beat their wives. Of course, American men do. Of course, African men do. Asian men, wherever you're going to find wife beating, you're going to find rape, you're going to find sexual abuse in any society. Why did that issue even come up? Well, one reason is because if it is sanctioned in Sharia that a man has the way that it has been interpreted, culturally a woman may have a recourse to her family or so on, but legally he has a right to beat her under the law of the state as it is interpreted today. For example, in Egypt, they even had a debate in parliament about the size of the stick with which he could beat her. It's regulated, it's true, but he has a different right than she does. She does not have a right to complain for a mild beating. As I said in the thing, it's regulated and it's moderation. It's in moderation. I think the difference to me would be that, at least in this society, the state is not approving of that. It goes on, but it's against the law. And but anyway, you know, there's. So that's the reason why, that's the difference that I would make.
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum.
I have a very short question from Ms. Scroggins. You said your definition of fundamentalism is what brought me up on the microphone. You said there's some people who want to do this, whatever you said. I know that. Did you try to find out why they want to do it?
Yeah. Yes.
Can you tell me what was the reason they gave you?
The reason they gave me is because they see it as their, well, I mean, different people gave different reasons, but some of the reasons that were offered were they see it as their religious duty, they see it as God's law, which if it were enforced properly, would create a just society as it did in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, and because they sincerely believe that Islam can offer a new alternative to society, you know, a better way of organizing society.
I think that is exactly the point. The whole issue is that they believe that these are God's laws. You
right.
said that. So therefore, they have a right to practice them. And they practice it not for a legislative purpose only. These laws have been legislated by God. So if they are Muslims, they have to follow that and they have to apply it. If you differ with them, that's fine, that is your right. But you cannot say, apply your own standards and values to those laws. Because that, you know, they are obviously two different things. You're trying to compare oranges and apples. So my comment is that please don't apply your standards to these laws, because in the belief of those people who follow them, they are much superior to man-made laws. Thank you very much.
Can I just add one thing to that?
Okay.
Okay, just one thing to that, because it does kind of get to an important issue. It's not a question of me applying. I mean, first of all, no one is suggesting, I don't think anywhere, that these people not be allowed to follow their own laws. The question that is raised by many Muslims, as well as Western people, is that these people want to impose their version of the laws on other people. And take, for example, the Pakistan Zina law. There might be plenty of Muslims who don't consider their laws to be Islamic at all. But that's the way these individuals interpret it. So.
The Muslim movement has been lost between the fundamentalists or the people who are extremists, let's say not fundamentalists, extremists, Muslims, and what the westernized or the westernized public or the liberal people or whatever we don't call them, the moderates. And we cannot, but Islam is an ideology. What he's saying, Islam is an ideology for life, and it's an ideology that applies to life. And actually, if you want to look at Islam, you don't look at the acts of Muslims, because Islam has been lost there for the past 100 years. It is the Muslim countries that has been divided by the power of the West and the power of colonialism. And this is what you see right now of oppression. Is not just against the woman and against every Muslim in these countries. Is the result of
the colonization of the countries. And that's
interesting.
Okay, just a quick comment about, this is kind of late, but about the lady that was saying why, you know, polygamy was so bad. I mean, I was watching the news, and here's a figure that 45% of all, you know, the newlyweds this year will file for divorce. I mean, why don't we view divorce that bad? You know what I mean?
Okay, thank you. I am going to now ask each speaker to give us approximately 2 minutes apiece of concluding statements, or as short as they can make it, please. I will ask whether one of you prefers to go first. If not, I'm going to go in the same order that we started. You want to go first?
No.
Okay. Go ahead, sister.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum. I'm very pleased that so many people came out. I know that the reasons for coming vary, okay? But inshallah, I hope there was some benefit in this for all of you, both the Muslim and the non-Muslim. You need to know a couple of things, though, okay? Deborah Scroggins researched and wrote the articles, okay? The headlines were done by the editor in each case. She didn't design the headlines. This is part of the editorial process in newspapers. Sometimes the writers will suggest the line that's going to be used, but most times they have, you know, people that go in and pull a sentence out of the copy to use to headline each story. I hope you will appreciate the effort she's put into it. But then at the same time, while I'm saying this to you, I'm also praying that whenever any journalist is writing about Islam in the future, that they make an effort to really separate what is a cultural practice and what is Islam, and not to allow that confusion to happen. And to be careful also that, that statistics that are used really represent the entire situation. There was a very interesting release from Associated Press just this last week that if that was the center of a story could cause quite an upheaval. The basics of it was that the number of children murdered by their primary caregivers increased by 11% in the last 12 months. The number of children sexually abused by their primary caregivers increased by 33% in the last 12 months. And that's here in this country. And I think it may be an indictment on our moral system that we have here. And it's something that we need to stop and think about when we're writing articles, when we're doing research. I will not condemn all Americans because these kinds of statistics have been brought to my attention on the radio, on television. I would like that the journalists and the readers not condemn all Muslims for things that some Muslims do, and that a greater effort is made to present the true picture of Islam. And if they have a question, that they should pick up this book right here, not just to depend on what people are saying to them, but to pick up this book here. I've been in the same places that Deborah's been. I know how many women there are happy. I know how many women there are struggling. And I know how much support we have as far as the women wanting Islamic law. There's a reason we want Islamic law. We know that if true Islamic law is restored, that we will have more rights, more privileges, more benefits than any American woman has ever dreamed of. And we want it. We want to have everything that Allah gave to women over 1400 years ago. And the Muslim women want this no matter what country they live in. It's our choice, and the choice is being made by knowledgeable, intelligent, educated women. Those are the ones that are at the forefront of the movement towards the establishment of Islamic governments. 90% of the women who are members of the International Union of Muslim Women have PhDs. These are intelligent women, and they represent almost every country
in the world at this time, and they all want one thing, the restoration of our Islamic rights.
Ms. Scroggins. Ms. Scroggins.
Well, I'll just be very brief and thank everybody for coming and for inviting me and for reading the articles. And I hope that it opened a debate. I think that the Islamic movement is something that anyone who's interested at all in I'm talking about the political movement here, either Islam or in the Middle East, can't fail to be fascinated with. And I hope that it opened up some discussion for people in the community to just think over some of the issues that are coming to the fore there.
Okay, I have three announcements before we conclude tonight. The Muslim Student Association, which has graciously arranged to put this on, would again like to thank those people at UWM who are responsible in assisting them in putting this program on. The MSA also runs on donations, and they do have a donation box outside. If you would be so generous, please donate to the MSA. As Secretary of the Islamic Society of Milwaukee, I would be remiss if I didn't also remind people, most of whom here know, that there is a fundraising dinner tomorrow night. Tickets for that will also be sold out in the hallway. At this point, I would like to personally thank all of you for coming tonight. I would like to personally thank each of the speakers who came from half a country away to be here this evening. And I hope that this debate was of help to those people and who attended tonight in getting a deeper understanding of the role of women in Islam and the situation of women in Islamic countries. Thank you very much. Good evening. Assalamu alaikum.